And welcome back to 10 Count. I'm Steve Kim, joined by Michael Baca of UCN Live and Ring Magazine editor Doug Fischer. Guys, December 2nd, we have a fight at the big room of the Madison Square Garden. Miguel Cotto and what he says is his swan song from professional prize fighting taking on Saddam Ali. All right. Is this more of a prize fight or a gold watch ceremony?
It's sort of an appreciation event for Miguel Cotto. It's in the right venue for Miguel Cotto because he's packed that arena as well as the last great Puerto Rican fighter, Felix Trinidad, did. You know, you and I have been there for some of those fights. One that really sticks out in my mind was his fight with Zab Judah, still dangerous Zab Judah, in 2007, in the month of June, the day before the Puerto Rican parade in New York City. And New Yorkers, hardcore New York fans, came out for Judah, but they also came out for Cotto. Puerto Rico definitely showed up for Cotto. And that arena was totally packed, literally to the rafters, over 20,000. And the atmosphere was just, it was electric, it was festive. In some ways, it was better than a Felix Trinidad fight, because for Felix Trinidad, it was like idolatry. It was just everybody was there screaming for Tito, 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 and the other guy who cared about him. But for this fight, it was for the fight itself, and they delivered. And that's what I'm really going to remember with Cotto, is that he struggled often. He didn't look like this unbeatable, invincible fighter like Felix Trinidad did in his prime, or some previous standouts from Puerto Rico like Wilfred Benitez or Wilfredo Gomez. But even though he had to grind out some hard decisions, even though he himself got beat and got stopped, sometimes in brutal fashion, he always gave 110%.
Doug, to your point, Miguel Square Garden, he led the Renaissance. New York was not a great boxing market. We had been there for the tournament for Don King, and that certainly hit. But a lot of other shows in New York were not doing well at that time. And from the time that Top Rank developed Cotto into that June slot, it became an event, and he helped revitalize that market. The thing I'm going to remember, Mike, about Miguel Cotto, and why I think boxing fans, whether you like him or not, should appreciate him: this guy took on Antonio Margarito when it wasn't convenient.
He took when Margarito was the boogeyman.
Right.
He was totally avoided.
Absolutely. When he took on Floyd Mayweather when he was a little bit older, and Floyd was still at very, very top form.
He was considered number one pound for pound.
Right. He also took on guys like Zab Judah.
He fought Manny Pacquiao in 2009.
His prime. Yeah.
Leave it at that. This is Pacquiao right after he nearly decapitated Ricky Hatton. He fought Pacquiao, and Pacquiao was the pack monster. Floyd Mayweather was not going to fight that version of Manny Pacquiao, okay? And people say Floyd Mayweather is an all-time great.
Right.
Cotto got in there with him. He got in there with guys who could hurt him. And you have to respect that. Did he have the best personality? Was he Mr. Charisma?
No.
Absolutely no. Not. No. No. His fights speak for his legacy.
Right. And here's the problem, though, Mike. Saddam Ali is not a bad fighter, but he is a welterweight, and a welterweight, bad whiskers, doesn't catch well.
At least he's been active, but it's been active at the welterweight division, which is a kind of a problem going up to
and not against top opposition.
Yeah, exactly.
Solid guys, but not world-class fighters.
You know, all the things you guys were mentioning about Miguel Cotto is really going to be things I'm going to be looking back upon as he, you know, peppers Saddam Ali around the ring for one last time.
I think Saddam
I think he's going to bludgeon. He's going to bludgeon.
I think Ali, you know, if he avoids getting clipped early, if he can get into his rhythm, he can be difficult for Cotto. Because guys at the stage of Cotto's career, with all the wear and tear and being in the mid-30s, they don't like to chase guys. And Ali, at his best, is a stick-and-move specialist who does have – he's got a lot of speed, but he's even got a little bit of pop. So that can be difficult for a guy, you know, who's already got one foot out the door in terms of his retirement.
Yeah, maybe the mental aspect can have a little bit of something to do with it. In the first round against Kamagai, we saw Cotto get slightly buzzed, just the slightest buzz, and it made it exciting for the first three rounds.
That fight let us know that Cotto still had his punch resistance, he still had his legs, his reflexes, and when he needs to, he can let his hands go. I think he threw more than 100 punches in that opening round.
Mm-hmm. Then he called out, Golovkin, Canelo, and ends up with Saddam Ali, huh?
Yeah, it was unfortunate. That draw kind of put some plans out into the back door. Now, fighters have a way of changing their minds in terms of retirement. I get the sense with Cotto, it is the end. He's been very, very adamant about that.
And he's made some good money in recent years.
But
I think he's deserving of a swan song like this as well.
Me
he's
too.
Put together a great
I'm not complaining about it.
Yeah, and, you know, the one concern I have about Ali, Jesse Vargas. Vargas is not a heavy puncher.
Under 10 KOs.
But that overhand right was booming, and it was sending. I've always said Saddam Ali, poor man's Amir Khan. That's not a good thing in this particular instance. Now, one thing about Miguel Cotto, he is a solid 54-pounder. He won the WBO belt. And Kama Guy tested him in terms of, do you still want to do this?
Because
Kama Guy's not skilled, but he's spirited. Mm-hmm. His temperament, it actually supersedes his talent. So he's going to test you in certain ways. Now, he's going to have to chase Saddam Ali. I don't think Saddam Ali has anything to keep Cotto off of him. That's the problem you have with this fight.
And he's never faced anybody near the class of Cotto. So, I mean, I think it's going to be a good goodbye for Cotto.
With that said, Miguel Cotto, first ballot Hall of Famer?
Sure, why not?
Absolutely. I don't even have to think about it.
Yeah, and I've also said he's on the Puerto Rican Mount Rushmore. I know some people put Camacho. Folks, Camacho the last 15 years, he was hard to watch. All right, well, that's it for this edition of 10 Count. On behalf of Michael Baca and Doug Fischer, this is Steve Kim saying goodbye, everybody.